I want to introduce Sister Lois Eckes, the beautiful other face on the screen with me here. Sister Lois came up with this title for tonight's event, The Unfolding Leaven of the Benedictine Life, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. Sister Lois has been a longtime retreat leader, spiritual director, former prioress of the community of sisters at St. Scholastica, and she now serves as the director of hospitality for both the monastery and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment. Those of you who already know Sister Lois are well aware that we are in for a wonderful treat tonight with her youthful, wise, loving spirit of peace. Sister Lois, welcome. Thank you so much for being here with us tonight to help us begin this series. And I know you have a prayer ready, so I'm going to turn it over to you and let you open us up with
prayer. Thank you, Don. I'm hoping that everyone can hear me. Is there any way to check that?
Yeah, okay.
Let us pray. O God, beyond all names, you are boundless love beyond all our imagining, dwelling within and embracing each of us and all creation in your wondrous goodness and compassion. You are the heart of everything, unfolding in and through us, revealing the interconnectedness of all things. We thank you for bringing us together tonight to reflect on the gift of Saint Benedict's wisdom and how it continues to be leaven for our lives and our world, deepening our awareness of the unfolding story of our lives and challenging us to live that sacred story with integrity, humility, courage, gratitude, and hope. Fill us with the grace to listen with the ear of our hearts to your Spirit speaking within us and through one another. As we spend this time virtually by necessity and yet soulfully by desire and intention, we pray in your holy name, surrounded by Benedict, Scholastica, and all the angels who are your messengers caring for our technology through the guidance of our wonderful Jean Anderson. We pray all this, as I said, in your holy name. Amen.
Thank you for that beautiful prayer that just sets such a lovely, lovely tone, lovely ambiance for the evening. You know, the title, The Unfolding Leaven of the Benedictine Life. I love that word, leaven. In fact, I must have been thinking about it all day long today because I actually made some bread and worked with you for today. So, you know, we worked together with the title, talking about the title and so forth, but this was your idea. So what are you thinking about, the unfolding leaven of the Benedictine life? What does that mean? What are you saying?
Well, leaven has a really very tender meaning for me, because one of my first memories as a little, I think I was probably about 6 years old, and I just have this picture, as it happened yesterday, of myself kneeling on the floor with a big stainless steel bread pan, and my sisters and my brother, who are also on the program with us tonight, can just imagine that with me. But anyhow, mother had me doing the first part of making the bread, and I felt so special and so privileged because I was her helper, and I was helping her make, because we had homemade bread all the time. In fact, if we bought bread, we called it at the store, we felt that was a treat. But anyhow, it was such a wonder to see how that yeast, that leaven, just grew and unfolded and expanded in that dough, and just stretched it and stretched it and stretched it until it was ready, of course, to be formed and shaped, and then rose and baked and transformed into beautiful, delicious bread that was became nurturing food for us and for whoever we shared our bread with. So I think of that, the spiritual happening, like the spirit at work in that dough of our lives, shaping us into the fullness of our potential that God has created us to know and to celebrate and to be and to share with one another. So our Benedictine life is like a leaven permeating the dough of our lives, our communities, our world, which I'll say more about as our time together unfolds. So it's just with our 1,520 years, I was thinking today, we used to say our 1,500 year tradition, which was marked back in 1980, but now we're in the year 2020. So it's our 1,520th traditional anniversary as Benedictines. And so it's about that leaven, that age-old leaven that continues to unfold, continues to permeate, continues to stretch and deepen and grow us as a community, and as I really believe as a world.
That's a beautiful image. So you speak about your childhood and just the impact of that experience of watching the yeast and helping your mother and so forth. Could you tell us a little bit about what drew you to the Benedictine life? What drew you to the Benedictine life? What drew you to this community of women?
Well, as I think about that question, what comes to my mind is I almost feel like it was in my DNA from the time I was conceived, because our parish was a Benedictine parish, and our school was, of course, a Benedictine school with the sisters, staffed by the sisters from our community here. And so mother and dad had them as teachers. We had Benedictine priests. And of course, my formation in grade school and high school and college was the Benedictine way of life. But how was I drawn? I guess really, Don, I'd have to say, it is really a very tender memory for me, but I remember, again, as if it were last night, we were in church at our little parish, Holy Name. We were at some devotions. I don't know if it was Lenten devotions or May devotions or October devotions, but the choir was singing. I think it was Holy God, We Praise Thy Name, which was the hymn we sang at the end of benediction. And we had a beautiful stained glass window of the Sacred Heart of Jesus up in the sanctuary. And I looked up there at that window at this particular moment when they were singing. And it was like Jesus came alive. Wow. And I heard him say in my heart, I want you to be mine. And I, you know, that little 9-year-old heart just took that in. I never, you know, I look back on it now and I really realize it was really a profound experience. It was a mystical experience. But I didn't think of it that way then. I just treasured it and kept it in my inner knowing. I didn't say anything to anybody, but it was just there. And then, so again, it was like 11 that was there and grew and was nurtured and spread into the dough of my life as I grew into my teenage years and into my time when I was ready to make a commitment. And so I was drawn to this community because this is this community of sisters I knew. And I loved, when I came here, I loved the whole sense of community. You know, the prayer, community prayer was beautiful, the liturgy, the hours, seeing the sisters care for one another, seeing the sisters involved in ministries of education and healthcare and spirituality, and but the whole sense of community is what really drew me. And I remember, as I'm reflecting on that now, when I, this is jumping ahead a bit, but when I took a class at St. John's on monastic formation, I had Father Timothy Kelly was my teacher in this particular class. He later became abbot, but I remember him saying one day in class, the most important ministry of a Benedictine community or a monastic community is to be community.
To be community.
To be community. That's your primary ministry, he said. And that's really what drew me in the beautiful prayer life and the way the sisters lived and cared for each other. I would say that's really what drew me. And that was nurtured all along.
Wow. Right, right. I'm thinking of that statement of Abbot Timothy's, that the most important thing is to be community. And I'm thinking about our world today, where we're facing pandemic and racial injustices and divisive systems, economic insecurity, climate events and catastrophes. How do we be community? Because community would be so important for all of us. You, as a religious community, are providing this beautiful example for it. How do we enact that in our own lives?
That is a very profound and deep question, Don. And I think it's one that that each of us in our circle of family life, however that is for us, that is something that we really need to ponder and we really need to talk about. It's, you know, it's how do we care for one another? Mm-hmm. I remember reading not too long ago a quote from Mother Teresa of Calcutta. She said, she was talking about peace. She said, we do not know peace in the world because we have forgotten that we belong to one another.
Hmm.
Is that powerful?
We have forgotten we belong to one another.
We have forgotten that we belong to one another. So how do we form community? We have to nurture that sense that we belong to one another. We are all connected, you know, and it's so beautiful how even science is showing us that today.
Yeah.
You know, that we're all the divine energy, the energy of life flows through all of us, all creation, you know, every part of creation. It's been doing that for 13.7 billion years, and it continues to unfold and grow and develop and stretch. So we're community as human beings, but we are also community with the earth. We're a community of life. And how does that manifest itself? It's how we care for one another.
Right.
I think of the Benedictine, you know, that we can switch the metaphors just a little bit here. And I think of that leaven is kind of like a prism.
Uh-huh.
And think of a prism as many facets. Uh-huh. So we can think of, you know, how do we be community, or how do we form community, or how do we nurture community? You know, we're talking about things like respect. We're talking about things like hospitality. We're talking about things like justice. We're talking about things like stewardship, good care of self, of each other, of the earth. We're talking about balance. We're talking about certainly peace. So many different values that we can imagine as facets in that charism. And by the way, it's like a charism, which charism is, that may not be a familiar word to a lot of folks, but charism is a Greek word that means gift. It's like, it's the gift that's meant to bless the whole community. It's a gift to be shared. It's a gift to be celebrated and developed and nurtured and grown. So each of us, in a sense, is a charism. You know, our personal life is a gift. And so in our Benedictine way of life, the rule of Benedict and the spirituality of Benedict as outlined in, as taught to us in the rule and in how we have interpreted that. By the way, that is a document that we have to continue to reinterpret because it was a 6th century document, you know, and Benedict would say, and we say too, you know what, he doesn't have a patent on those values. We talk about Benedictine values. He doesn't have a patent on those, and he certainly would say that, because what the genius of Benedict was that he was able to take that tradition that preceded him and glean the essence. What are the things that constitute a nurturing community of life? What are the values that will help a person and a community to flourish, to their full flowering? So we can talk about the smallest unit of a domestic family. We can talk about the community of a, you know, like a religious community. We can talk about the community of a town or a city or a school or a, you know, a place where we work, you know. So that word community just has so many ways that we can understand it and we can experience it.
Yeah. Thank you. When I'm thinking about this leaven, you know, this metaphor that we're using of leaven, and that beautiful quote by Mother Teresa, "We have forgotten that we belong to one another." I'm wondering how your community is doing. How are they doing in the midst of this pandemic? And how are you doing? How are you all in the midst of, sometimes it feels like the world is crumbling around us. How are you remembering that you belong to one another?
That's such a good question. Oh gosh. Well, I think as far as our community goes, Don, and I know we have some sisters who are participating tonight, and I hope they would agree with me. I think we are handling this time of the pandemic and the unrest that's beyond the pandemic, or maybe even somehow fueled by the pandemic. I don't know. There's a reason why all of this is happening at the same time. I think we're handling it nobly. I wrote these words down: nobly, creatively, nimbly, patiently, mindfully, gratefully, prayerfully, and hopefully.
And maybe very intentionally.
Intentionally, there you go. That I didn't put that one in there, but that would be another one, right? And I think what's happening, I'm speaking personally, but I believe I'm speaking for others as well in our community. I think this is this time when we're really working to care well for one another. So, you know, we're very intentional, using that word, intentional and careful about wearing our masks and doing our social distancing and, you know, doing all we can to care for and protect each other. You know, the world gets it too in some ways. The ad that sometimes on TV from Uber that says, "Wear your mask because you are protecting Peter, who's protecting Mary, who's protecting Don," you know, the whole idea that we do it because we care for each other and we want each other, all of us to be safe. So I think what's happening is that we're really deepening our attention and our care for each other. We really miss the fact that we can't relate. You know, we can't go visit our sisters on Banner Hall, but it's because they need to be safe. So we miss them terribly, but we figure out ways of connecting with them through virtual events, and also even out on the garden court. We kind of go out there sometimes and keep our distance, but at least we can see them face to face outside where it's more safe. Also, I think what we're doing is becoming more centered and grounded in our personal and community prayer. And I think this might be true for others besides myself, but when we sing our hymns and pray our psalms and listen to scriptures and our sacred readings that we have at the Liturgy of the Hours, it's like seeing it through a whole different lens, you know, interpreting it, seeing it through the eyes of the pandemic, seeing it through the eyes of the racial injustices that are just becoming so exposed, you know, and to see the heartbreak that has been forever, you know, in our human family. So we see ourselves really, I think, growing in solidarity with our suffering world, mm-hmm. and very mindful of the huge heartbreak, the huge challenges and sadness that there is in the lives of so many people. And, you know, we could go on and list all the ones we know, but we pray every day. We pray in our Liturgy of the Hours and at Eucharist, and certainly personally, we pray for all the needs of our world. Mm. And it's beautiful, so the prayers that the sisters will voice when they're the lector at Mass or the leader at evening prayer. We have a whole board full of prayer intentions that we look at and we pray for every day. Appreciating the time to really, you know, enjoy one another, and also appreciating the beautiful gift of creation. Yes. I think making time to just be with the beauty all around us, and to let ourselves be blessed by it, to experience God's presence in it, and to maybe deepen our desire and our commitment to care well for it. Not that we haven't been doing that, but it's like maybe again with fuller intention and appreciation. Yeah. Mm. Those are some of the things that come to mind. Certainly gratitude for our health, for all the ways that we are blessed to be able to be here together, and we are not isolated. You know, we're isolated in the sense we're not out doing the work that we do outside the monastery grounds, but we're doing it for each other and for the larger community as well.
Greater good. And we have had a really, really beautiful summer here that I've really enjoyed myself. You know, when you're thinking about that, when you're thinking about the context in which we find ourselves today, with all these things happening in the world, is there a particular Benedictine value that you would say is maybe most relevant for you, or most appropriate to really emphasize? How would you approach that?
Yeah, well, I mentioned before this prism and the different facets, mm-hmm. and I named some of those values, but I think the one, Don, that comes to me now, with all that's happening in our world and our lives, I think the one that I would name would be respect.
Mm. Yeah.
Respect. And, you know, respect comes from the Latin word respectare, which means to look again.
Mm.
To look again. So it's like, I look again at this person, or I look again at this event, or I look again at, you know, it could be a piece of a situation, or even creation. I look again and see it with fuller eyes, with a listening heart, you know, with the eyes of my soul and with the ears of my heart, and heart meaning the very core of who I am. Mm-hmm. So it's, I think that, you know, the world is crying out for that value to be lived, to respect the other, because he or she is a precious gift of creation. Mm-hmm. With a potential, has the right to be loved, to be respected, to be cared for, to be nurtured, to be given opportunities for growth and for full nurturing of their person. So I think that's the one, and I think the others flow from that, because if I am living that value of respect, you know, I'm going to welcome the other. That's hospitality. I'm going to welcome the other. You know, there's this book by by Valerie Carr. I think some of you know it. It's called See No Stranger. She has a beautiful, beautiful passage. I just want to say it fits right here very well. She says, we are all indivisibly part of one another. We can look upon the face of anyone or anything around us and say, as a moral declaration and a spiritual, cosmological, and biological fact, you are a part of me I do not yet know. Yeah. Oh, isn't that powerful? You are a part of me I do not yet know. So
it is very powerful. I'm reading the same book, and just to sit with even that statement and think about it for every facet of creation, not just people, not just animals, but the trees and the ground and everything that we're impacting that is feeling like it's coming to crisis now. When you holding all this conversation we've had, is there one particular thing that the pandemic has taught you?
Wow. I think it's taught me not to take life for granted. Not to take my own life for granted, not to take the lives of others for granted, my family, my community, my friends, just our way of life. We've been so used, I so miss giving people hugs. I so miss being able to welcome people to the monastery for prayer, for retreats, for programs, not to take that for granted, not to take, so that would be one thing I think that I really have learned. Mm. And also to really listen more deeply with the ear of my heart and to see more fully with the eyes of my soul, because there's so much beauty all around us. Mm. And sometimes in the fullness of all the busyness, I guess, I don't like to say I'm busy. I like to say my life is full. But in reality, sometimes it is more busy than it is full because I don't maybe pay attention. So there's just making time or being aware of the beauty, of the simplest beauty, of a smile, a kind word, a gift outside in creation. Oh my gosh. Okay. There's so much to stop and just be in wonder of, taking time to watch the butterflies and the bees and the birds and all the gifts of creation there's more, but I know we don't have time to go into all of it right now.
Do you think that, well, I guess our faith teaches us that God speaks to us through everything. And so one of the things that a lot of people have speculated about in the last several months is, how is God speaking to us through these world events that are touching everybody on the planet? How is God speaking?
Well, one of the things I think God is saying to us, people, I'm here. I haven't gone out to lunch. I haven't abandoned you. I'm here. I'm right here, smack dab in the middle of all of this.
Open your eyes. Yeah.
Eyes and your heart. Exactly. I'm here. I'm within you. I'm an indwelling God as well as a God who embraces all. I hold you in my heart and I'm with you. I'm with you and I'm doing something new. Wake up, pay attention, listen with the ear of your heart. You're all connected. You are all one with me. I love you to the point of tears. And I think that I just love that, because there is a psalm, and I forgot to note it here for my notes, but there's a psalm that talks about God collecting our tears in God's flask. Mm-hmm. And in that flask are God's tears mingled with ours. So God weeps for us, with us, and in us. Our God is a God who experiences our suffering with us and yet is beyond it, mm-hmm. transforming it, giving us hope, mm-hmm. that that this is not the end and that there is new life. Something is gestating. Something is being born. I just think it's so powerful to think of that. We don't know where we're going, but we know that where we're going is guided by God's love, and it's going to be fullness of life in some way. It's going to be different. So there's a lot of letting go we have to do. And, you know, again, Benedict says it's woven throughout his whole rule, but that whole sense of God's presence. And he says in chapter 4 at the very end, with the tools of good works, he says, never lose hope in God's mercy. I just love that. Never lose hope in God's mercy. And mercy is in the Hebrew scriptures, or in the Hebrew scriptures, that word mercy is God's womb love.
Yeah.
God's womb love. Never lose hope in the tender womb love of God that God has for us. Yeah, it's that intimate and that deep and that old. Yeah.
You know, and there's a lot of people that are experiencing things today that would have a lot of difficulty seeing that, believing that, feeling that. What do you suppose Scholastica might say to those people?
Well,
we didn't practice this question, folks.
I think, you know, the sisters know this story, and some of the rest of you who are listening know this story, but I just, and Don, I shared this with you, and I think you, maybe it was okay if I share it here. You know, it was Benedictine Scholastic. I had this custom of, you know, meeting regularly for their visit, because they were twins. Their brother and sister, tradition has it that they were twins. And in those days, you know, it was unusual for that kind of connection to be able to happen. Usually it was you left your family and that was it, you know, till you met in heaven. But anyhow, Benedict, again, his moderation and his sense of connection and community, so they would meet on a regular basis. Well, they were meeting this particular time, and it was getting late, and she wanted to continue visiting, and he said, no, it's getting dark, I got to get home. You know what the rule is, my sister, what are you talking about? So she just kept quiet, and she put her head down. The story says, it's written in St. Gregory's account of their life, of Benedict's life. And she put her head down and prayed, and the sky was clear, and, you know, before this. And so when she started to pray, in come the clouds, in comes the thunder, in comes the lightning, in comes this downpour. And he couldn't think of leaving. And so he said, God forbid, what did you do, sister? And she said, well, I asked a favor of you, and you said no. And I asked God, and God said yes. And so St. Gregory says here, surely it is no more than right that her influence was greater than his, since hers was the greater love. So I think what Scholastica would say to us today, Don, would be, Scholastica would say, learn to love well.
Oh.
Learn to love well, and learn to love what that means. A love that is tender and unselfish and has good boundaries, Benedict says in the last chapter the second of the last chapter, chapter 72, he talks about the good zeal of the monastics, and he talks about how to show love for one another. You know, be the first to let go of what you think has to be, and listen to the other person, because maybe they have something to say or something to add that will make a better decision here.
This love that you're talking about, Sister Lois, is the action sometimes has to happen first. We don't always feel all warm and fuzzy in here, but we're still called by our faith, by our tradition, to act in love. And then the other follows.
Exactly, because it's not about feeling. It's about a commitment, right?
Right.
That's thank you for saying that, Don. Yep. It's about a commitment. Yep. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm. As Benedict, I just want to share this one quote from chapter 72. He says, no one is to pursue what she judges better for herself, but instead what she judges better for someone else. And then before that, he had said to support one another with the greatest patience, caring for one another's, respecting one another's weaknesses of body or behavior, and earnestly competing in obedience to one another. And by that he means by listening, because obedience comes from the Latin word, which means to hear, to listen. So compete with one another in being the one with the attentive heart. And that's really open to hear what you have to say, the other has to say. So that's how we nurture love.
Which is very interesting, because in our society, you know, we're kind of taught to compete to get our words out, mm-hmm. instead of listening to one another. Mm-hmm. And this is a great segue into, I think we need to move to getting some comments and or questions from our attendees. Attendees, you've got a chat function somewhere on your Zoom screen. For me, it's on the bottom. Some people have told me it's up on top. But if you could just hover your cursor around and you'll find that chat option. And I think that we had hoped to be able to have you be able to raise your hand. It's not working the way we wanted it to. So if you would please send, and we've got a comment that has come in. So I'm assuming it to let me know if you don't want me to say your name. And Maria, yours came in before I even gave people the options. So I hope it's okay that I'm using your name. From Maria, what has been the hardest challenge for you, Sister Lois, during this difficult time, and how have you overcome it, or have you overcome it?
Well, I think I said it maybe before. The hardest challenge for me is not being able to welcome people to come to share in whatever we can share in terms of our community, with prayer and with coming for retreats, for quiet, for silence, for face-to-face spiritual direction, for example, or, you know, just coming to share their lives with us in the ways that we've done it in the past. I think that it's a form of isolation, and that's been really hard. And how do I overcome it? I don't know that I've overcome it. I think I just accept. I mean, it's something I can't change. It's like the serenity prayer, you know, give me the grace to change what I can, and the wisdom and the courage to live with what I can, change what I can and live with what I can't. The serenity prayer. Give me the wisdom to know. Yeah. So right. I think that's basically what it is. And finding other ways to connect with people, I think that's more phone calls, more letters, more virtual when we can do that. Thank God for Zoom.
Thank God for Zoom. Yes. And attendees, participants, another thing that we would love to hear from you too is how the Benedictine life has been important in your own life. How have you been formed by the Benedictine life? So go ahead and send your questions or comments in. We have one. We have one from Carrie. Do you see it? In addition to the priority of respect, what wisdom from the rule of Saint Benedict can help us cope with the political and racial tensions of today? That's a big one.
Well, certainly, I think of how Benedict, in the, actually that's chapter 3 of the Rower, he talks about how the whole community should be gathered in, and the whole community should be listened to, including the youngest, because mm-hmm. it's often to them to whom God reveals what is best. And I think of that in our world today, and our political arena, all of us, all that's so difficult for us. I think having that attitude of listening to the people who are on the margins, the people who are struggling to have their rights respected, the people who are poor, the people who are living with the uncertainty of how they're going to even put their next meal on the table, or who don't have work, or that all that economic insecurity, and social insecurity or alienation. Yeah, so Benedict talks about everyone has a voice, and everyone needs to have a chance to speak their truth and have that be respected. Yeah. Sure. Also, certainly the sense of going deep into our inner will, our wellspring within, and praying for strength, for wisdom, for light, to live with integrity, and to show up with our truth, and to have the courage to speak it with respect, with as being, that helps.
As being a part of respecting others is standing in our own truth. Was that what you mm-hmm. were saying? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so much of this is flowing out of our Catholic social teaching of reverence for all. We're all made in the image of God. Our dignity, yeah.
Yes, in fact, I think reverence and respect could be equated.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I really do, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We're not hearing from anyone else. Does anyone else have any comments? Oh, here comes from Marilyn. We love the wise and welcoming community that embrace us as we are, comfort us when we are hurt or grieving, and teach us the true meaning of love and connection. This gives us hope, energy, and the ability to keep loving even through the darkness. We thank you and love you. And I would say ditto. And for that, mm-hmm. we are grateful, very, very grateful for your witness. And that's from Amy too.
But if I might just...
Yes, please.
If I could just say, Don, but I think we are also very blessed and inspired by all of you. And I think that's something that we're really missing. Yeah, that's one thing. That form of isolation that I was talking about that we experience. I mean, we have each other, which is great, but we are also fed and inspired by all of you, and we treasure that. You are a gift to us. You are truly that, and we miss not having that in person. We know it's there.
We miss that nurturing, that nurturing of our souls and our hearts, yeah.
We do.
Well, I have a question. One of the things I've become aware, or another question, one of the things I have found myself time to time during these last 5-6 months, things can get so serious, things can get so heavy, and all of a sudden
what?
Did you hear me? I said,
no.
Oh, I said, during the pandemic, at times I've become aware of how serious and heavy all the news constantly coming out, and I've had to just shut myself down away from the news and not read it as much as I was, especially at the beginning. But sometimes I come to this point and I say, oh my gosh, when was the last time I laughed? Mm-hmm. Or my son, when was the last time I heard my son laugh? And so I'm wondering, you know, laughter is so important for us mentally, spiritually, physically even. So what are you doing to laugh? What are you doing for fun? Mm-hmm. Just light fun.
Mm-hmm. You know, that's such a good question, and I don't do it enough, but I know it's because I think it's when I'm attached to how I think things should go or how things attach to that basically would be it, you know, things not going the way I want or when I want it to happen. So trying to be, to let go and, you know, and just really, I think again, if I open my eyes, the eyes of my heart, my soul, and I mean, I'm looking at up at my bulletin board here with pictures of all my family, and I've got the sweetest pictures of every one of them smiling. My little grandnephew, Earl, holding his little chicken. And when I'm too serious here in my office, I look up and his precious smile just makes me melt. And I just let go. What am I being so uptight about, Lois? You know, here's this beautiful child who is full of life and full of love and being so nurtured by his beautiful mother and dad. You know, I think gratitude also helps. You know, helps. Yeah. But how do I don't laugh enough, but some of our sisters do, and I love to hear them laugh because it ignites something in me. But I think we really do have to surround ourselves with even the beauty of creation, and even I know, maybe we have to choose some readings that are more lighthearted, or maybe we have to figure out ways to play games that you know, that help us to relax and connect with each other it's one of my challenges. I must be honest and say it's one of my challenges not to be so serious. Yeah.
Well, but it's interesting that you connect it to being attached to something, because, you know, we think about that quite easily, or a lot of us do anyway, in terms of our own personal lives, right? But I think we can get really attached to how we think the world should be working too. And that's been really it's prevalent right now. We want certain things to be happening, and it's happening in completely other ways. We have a question here from Joan. She asks, where should one go when darkness is more than the light? Where should one go when darkness is more than the light?
That's a profound question.
Mm-hmm. It sure is.
What comes to me just without thinking more fully and deeply about it is, I would say for myself as well as for Joan, I would go looking for the light, because it's there. You know, the darkness is not, the light will always overcome the darkness, even in the greatest darkness. Like, you know, you think of that little light that's burning. You know, no matter how big the darkness is, there's always that eternal flame, as it were. There's always that inner light. There's always light. And if the darkness seems to be all there is, I would say I have to go looking for the light and just trust that my inner being will, the spirit will guide me to where that is. It could be as simple as spending time admiring a flower or a bird or listening to a song or seeking out a friend who I trust, who can be light for me, who can be light for me in my darkness. What would you say, Don?
Music. Actually, they've done a lot of studies about sad classical music actually being very good for us when we're feeling down. And so when I'm feeling melancholy and dark, I will often listen, you know, I have a Spotify account and I go on there and I pull up sad classical music, and it's amazing what it does to me. Looking at my son, trying to be mindful of so much in my life to be grateful for, and also not expecting that the darkness will just dissipate just because I do a few of those things. I'm aware, more and more aware, that these things take time, and so patience with myself, patience with the world. Yeah.
One more thing I would add to that. I love what you just said. One more thing I would add to that, Don and Joan, would be to trust that in the darkness there is hidden a gift, a seed of life, a new life. Mm-hmm. You think of the darkness within the womb. You know, you think of the darkness of that seed that's underground. You know, you think of just what is hidden in that darkness. What is the gift that is germinating or waiting to manifest itself? So sometimes it's a matter of, as you said, just being there and trusting that something is going to be revealed, or some way the light is going to break. Mm-hmm. Is going to break through.
Sometimes I think when we resist sadness, when we resist darkness,
I think Dan Eckes brought a piece of wisdom up here.
He says, listen to your heart, which is the divine and also lives in the dark. You will be guided. He also said a little earlier, Daniel Eckes, who I'm assuming is your brother.
Yes, my dear brother. Yes.
He says, sister, Father Richard Rohr would be very proud of you and your presentation, on with the connection through community. We are connected and with the incarnate Christ as God, the divine is within all of us. Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
Thank you, Danny.
And we have a comment from Rita, who says, I feel that laughter is a part of community and connection. In our current world of distancing and not being physically present with one another, it is hard to do the same things that create laughter together. So Sister Lois's comment about playing games by Zoom and making sure that virtual connections include fun is important to include. Yes. I'm sure that there's lots of more questions and comments with all of you. But unfortunately, we have gotten to the end of our time together. I'm aware with all the Zoom interactions I've had that an hour is about what we can do. without it being so tiring for us. So I just want to thank you all for being here. This has been wonderful. And we have our next Benedictine Conversation, I want to let you know, on October 6th with Dr. Bernie Evans from St. John's School of Theology in Collegeville, Minnesota. And his presentation will be entitled, The Common Good, Creating Conditions for Everyone to Do Well. And that registration link will be coming out later this week. And so you can register then. What is that? I'm sorry?
Was this recorded tonight? Recorded
tonight. Maria just sent in another comment, says, thank you both and many blessings to you. Yes, this is recorded and we will get this up on our website, and we hope to continue hosting them on our center website so that we have them in archive under Benedictine Conversations. So we're really excited about this, and I hope that you all have a chance to look at our blog postings. We're keeping up on that. And now, from Joan, thank you both for your gifts. Thank you. From Laura, thank you for this inspirational hour. Thank you all for being here. And Sister Lois, thank you. Thank you for your heart. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your wisdom. Thank you for sharing it with us tonight.
You're most welcome, and thank you all. It's such a joy to know that we're surrounded by so many beautiful people who are such examples of the goodness and the love of our Creator, of our divine beloved who lives within us and embraces us all and is with us in the darkness. Yeah, the light in the dark. Yeah. Right. And so I'm most grateful, and I know that some of my dear family were part of the group, and I just call out to you with great gratitude, plus all of my friends, all of our friends. Oh, I look at the list and I think, oh my gosh, I think I know everybody almost on this list. It was so precious. Oh, thank you so much. And some of my own sisters in community. So this has been beautiful. Yeah. And thank you for your being the host and being the interviewer. It was really fun to do this with you.
We want to have fun with these.
Yes. One of my sisters said, be sure that you aren't too serious. So I hope I wasn't too serious tonight.
We talked about serious things, but like we've also talked about having fun and remembering that part of ourselves is so important. Yeah. So anyway, Sister Lois, what words do you have to leave us with tonight that we can all go off to slumber land with this beautiful inspiration from you?
Thank you, Don. Well, this is so interesting because of the question that Joan asked about where do you find the light in the darkness, or where do you go when all you see is darkness? Actually, I felt as I prayed about a closing message or whatever for us tonight, what came to me was this beautiful poem by Jan Richardson. Some of you know it, and I think I've shared it with some of you. It's from her book, Circle of Grace, A Book of Blessings for the seasons. And it's called Blessed Are You Who Bear the Light. And I share this with all of you and with great gratitude because you all are bearers of the light. Bearers of the light. For me, for each other, for our world, you are all a treasure. Even if you feel you're in the dark, you are a bearer of light. So, blessed are you who bear the light in unbearable times, who testify to its endurance amid the unendurable, who bear witness to its persistence when everything seems in shadow and grief. Blessed are you in whom the light lives, in whom the brightness blazes, your heart a chapel, an altar, where in the deepest night can be seen the fire that shines forth in you in unaccountable faith, in stubborn hope, in love that illumines every broken thing it finds. You are bearers of the light. Thank you. And know you are loved.
And thank you for illuminating our evening. And you are loved. Blessings to all.